Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dragon's Claw, a Dorina Basarab novella, by Karen Chance, narrated by Joyce Bean. Chapter 1. I left a hot guy and a warm bed for this? I towed over the nearest corpse, which, as expected, was of the fanged variety. Not surprising. The vampire senate, the bastards who had dragged me out of bed at this infernal hour, could give a rat's ass about anybody else. Mages, weirs, humans, they could kill each other with impunity, as far as the Senate was concerned, and more power to them. But vamps were another story. A whole lot of vamps, I thought, glancing around the large basement room. It was dark, with the only light coming from a flickering set of ancient fluorescents full of bug bodies. It was dank, with unfinished brick walls laced with mold and puddles of water spotting the discolored concrete subfloor. It smelled. My bed had smelled too, like warm silken butterscotch, the scent of my boyfriend's skin. I sighed.
Well, what do you make of this?
The demand came from the asshole who'd brought me here and who was crouched on the other side of the body. The dark, curly head was bent, showing off the earring he wore in true Elizabethan style, which was sort of back in again. The clothes weren't. It looked like he'd been rousted out of bed, too, and had thrown on some 16th-century slops and an overlarge linen shirt, which I guess was what he wore around the house. That was weird enough, although it was mostly hidden by a Columbo-esque trench coat. But the ensemble was also clashing with the rain boots he'd found somewhere, because it was bucketing down outside. They were red and had ladybugs on them. I eyed them worriedly. He looked deranged, and that's coming from someone who should know.
Well?
Angry brown eyes looked up at me, and the tiniest hint of fang glinted out of an overgrown goatee. Because, believe it or not, Marlowe was a master vamp. And a powerful one, being the Vampire Senate's chief spy. I guess that's why nobody had mentioned the boots.
Your boys let you go out like that?
I asked, squatting down and shooting them a look. Vamp number one upped the oomph on the evil eye he'd been giving me since I came in, but his counterpoint looked vaguely chagrined. Other people's masters went around in Armani and Dior. Theirs looked like an eccentric hobo. It was embarrassing.
I'm not in the mood tonight.
Marlowe growled me a warning. For what, I didn't know. Like he was ever in the mood to deal with me, or vice versa. I yawned and turned my attention to the body. Attractive, Asian, young. And the latter wasn't just in appearance. The old vamps tended to draw up like desiccated mummies when they died, with all the years their power had staved off suddenly coming home to roost. Some of the really old ones could even puff away like the CGI creations on Buffy, the result of centuries of time smacking into them all at once, pulverizing even their bones. Not this guy. He made a beautiful corpse, and one dressed way too well for the venue. The silk tie was maybe a couple $100, and the shoes were at least $1,000. One of the perks of being the daughter of a clothes horse was that I knew men's fashion, and this guy believed in gilding the lily. Or he had, before fate caught up with him in the form of a bullet through the brain. I frowned and started unbuttoning his shirt. The body had 4 bullet holes in total, including the one making him look like he had a third eye. A master would have spit out the slug and cussed you before he ended you, but to a young vamp, that sort of thing is no joke. It might have put him out anywhere from a few hours to a few days. What it wouldn't do was kill him.
Why's this guy dead?
I asked, looking up at Marlowe.
That's what you're here to tell me.
Spelled?
No.
You're sure?
Of course I'm sure.
He gestured angrily at a small man in a beige off the rack who was trying to look invisible in a corner. He wasn't trying very hard, or he'd have likely succeeded, because he was a mage, probably one of those connected to Marlowe's family, which meant that he was a good one. a good and chagrined one, because his abilities had turned up squat. Of course, so had mine. The residual stench of magic was nowhere to be found, not that my nose could detect anyway. And since another of Marlowe's boys was busy snuffling around the corners, I wasn't likely to pick up anything he'd overlooked. Vamps with his abilities were better than the bloodhounds they were named after. But the fact remained that this guy shouldn't be dead. He shouldn't be glitching like a video game character, I thought, starting slightly when the body began jerking and twitching and hopping the way a dead guy shouldn't. And wasn't, because Marlowe hadn't so much as blinked, although he was jerking now too. Like his boys by the door, like the scattered bodies on the floor, and like the crazy fluorescence, which suddenly resembled a nightclub strobes. Shit. I didn't know what was happening, but I was pretty clear on why. Like so many things in my life, it was a legacy from dear old Dad, who had been that rarest of rare vamps, one made by a curse and not a bite. That had caused him a few problems in the early years, since he hadn't had a master to teach him the ropes or even to make him go Betty by while the change did its thing. No, he had stayed awake through it all, clueless little princeling that he'd been, too busy dealing with an uprising among his nobles to concentrate on the really strange stuff happening to him. In the meantime, he'd stolen a few moments to visit my mother, because of course he had. Other than for the famous Basarab name, his diplomatic skills, and his position as second in command of the North American Vampire Senate, Mircha is mostly known for being a randy little bugger. Okay, a randy big bugger, since he's 6 feet in his socks, despite having been born in an age when a lot of guys barely hit my 5 feet too. But Daddy's always been luckier than he deserved, like when his half-living, half-undead sperm engendered bouncing baby me. The fact that I did not come out with a tail or any of the other legendary attributes of the misbegotten hybrids known as Domfears seems to surprise most vamps I meet. I suppose they think they'll see one of us coming, a slouching monster announcing its penchant for vamp killing by its grotesque appearance and slathering maw, and instead get taken down by a petite, dark-haired, dimple-faced woman in jeans and a stylish leather jacket. That probably explains why the last expression on many a vamp's face has been outraged disbelief. Kind of like the chief spy was wearing now.
"What is wrong with you?" Marlowe demanded.
I didn't answer. My vision had stopped dancing and started flipping through a catalog of new ways to see, some of which I couldn't even name, although I recognized ultraviolet, infrared, and something that at first glance appeared to be grayscale, until I looked up at Marlowe again.
"Whoa,"
I said originally, staring at the chief spy in what I guess was a less than sane way because he scowled.
"Get a grip."
"I have a grip," I told him, still blinking in shock. At least I was pretty sure. Unfortunately, I also had a consciousness split between my sort of human half and my full-bore vampire side, which had all kinds of abilities I don't, and which I couldn't access until very recently, thanks to the mental wall that Mircha had put in my mind when I was just a kid. Most Domfears can't reconcile their two natures and quickly go mad. Mircha had helped me avoid that fate by using some of his newly acquired vamp mental skills to separate the two halves of my brain. Namely, into a mostly human side with a few bonus points in perception and reaction time, and a mostly vamp side with, well, who the hell knew, I thought, gazing at Marlowe, whose face had turned into what looked a lot like an X-ray. The recent demise of Mircha's mental barrier, thanks to a psychedelic substance known as Fey Wine, had left me able to see a lot more than normal. But this was new, like really new, I thought, staring at the bones in Marlowe's face and neck, which were shining through the now mostly transparent skin.
"Whoa,"
I said again softly, and touched his cheek. Marlowe flinched, which was fair considering the number of times we'd laid into each other over the years, but he didn't pull away. Even when I ran a thumb over the long-heeled crack in his left eye socket, where someone had belted him once centuries ago, because a vampire would have healed that seamlessly in moments. So it was from his human days, I thought, and the words had a weird mental echo, like someone else had had the same idea at the same time. That should have freaked me out, but my brain brushed it off, too busy examining the history of the man writ in his bones. The nose had been broken at some point, too. The cartilage was fine now, but the bones underneath told the story, like several of the teeth spearing up into his gums, which were fake. He must have had them put in during modern times, because Elizabethan dentistry sucked. The vampire fangs kept trying to push past them, but he pulled them back in, although he didn't speak. I didn't either, but someone else did.
You were pushed, yes?
Dorina's voice slithered out of my mouth, lower, silkier, more naturally sibilant than mine. Marlowe twitched. I couldn't see his eyes. We were still in X-ray mode, so I didn't know what expression was in them. But the body I'd half crawled onto at this point suddenly got a lot stiffer.
What?
The voice sounded weird, too, kind of shrill.
Your master,
Dorina explained patiently, more so than I'd have expected from her.
She pushed you, did she not?
I blinked, because that was news to me. It also explained a lot. Most vamps are made the same way. Bite, dirt nap, rebirth, baby stage, followed by a slow progression up the power ladder to wherever they eventually stall out, most at a level far below that of master. I had never thought about it, but I'd always assumed that Marlowe had been created the same way, since there weren't a lot of alternatives. Even those cursed instead of bitten progressed along the same path, just skipped that first bit. But there was one more possibility, although I'd never known anyone changed that way. Maybe because most of those who attempt it end up burnt to a crisp.
Wait, you were pushed?
I asked, and for some reason Marlowe jerked again.
Who is speaking?
He demanded.
What?
Who is speaking to me right now?
That last one was me, I said, but it didn't seem to help. In fact, it seemed to make things worse, judging from the way he was suddenly trying to crawl out from under us and trying hard. Dorina stopped that with a hand on his shoulder, slightly pressing down.
Master?
That was one of the vamps by the door.
Stay back,
Marlowe ordered, although his voice sounded a little strangled.
Are you sure? We can stay back, damn you.
They stayed back. Dorina traced a finger up Marlowe's arm, following the line of bone. There were several layers of cloth between digit and skin, but it didn't matter. Her vision laid everything bare, like one of those dissected bodies where you can see muscle and sinew and bone all at once.
Yes, I see,
she murmured, and suddenly so could I. We leaned closer, fascinated by the crackalure of fractures that mapped the entire surface of his skeleton. They were strangely beautiful, a cobweb design slightly darker than the surrounding bone, etched into the very fabric of his body. They were crystallized now, solidified, set in something many times harder than steel. But once they'd been a hair's breadth from shattering into a million pieces.
Your master took you to the brink,
Dorina confirmed, finally touching skin as our questing finger pushed aside the fabric at his collar.
Why?
The Adam's apple moved up and down, a telltale sign of Marlowe's discomfort. But to my surprise, he answered,
She needed a master.
So she made one.
Dorina's voice was thoughtful.
You did not mind?
Marlowe's sudden laugh was cut off quickly, but it made me jump. He didn't do a lot of laughing.
No.
Why? It could have killed you.
It had almost killed him, I thought, staring at unmistakable evidence of that fact. Not too strange, I guessed. The push is hardcore. Instead of the small amount of power usually conveyed through the bite, to give the baby vamp something to use as a power source for the change, in a push, the floodgates are opened all the way, condensing what should take centuries into a matter of moments, and resulted, not in a baby, but in a brand new master vampire. Or at least that was the theory. In reality, most bodies shatter and combust under that amount of power, which is why I'd never seen a successful push, and I am considerably older than my 20-something appearance would suggest. In fact, it's so dangerous that it's usually reserved for times of desperation, like a war, when more masters are needed pronto. I wondered why it had been done to Marlowe.
Why?
Dorina asked again, echoing my thoughts, as she lowered us down to the skull, which abruptly shifted back to normal, giving me a close-up of a face that had always reminded me more of a Spaniard than an Englishman, with a slight golden hue to the skin, curls that were more black than brown, and thick, dark lashes around slightly heavy-lidded eyes that were usually whiskey dark, but right now were reddish-brown fire.
"Because I didn't have anything to lose," he snarled.
And the next moment, I was hitting the wall, on the far side of the room. For a second, I thought we might have a problem. Dorina came off the wall before I fully registered hitting it, in a liquid motion I couldn't track, despite being in the body making it. And suddenly, we were back across the room, a hand gripping the now-standing Marlowe's throat, her face in his. But then something strange happened. Really strange. Our hand on his throat softened and curved around the back of his neck, and our other hand, the one that had somehow grabbed a knife and all that, slowly slid it back into its sheath. For a second, no one spoke. Not me, not Dorina, and not Marlowe. He was standing there, red-faced and furious, but also strangely off balance, with a weird expression in those dark eyes, which only increased when Dorina abruptly let him go and stepped back. "My apologies," she said quietly, and then she was gone. Chapter 2. Dorina's abrupt departure left me staggering, and then sitting down hard on top of a very unforgiving corpse. It had a gun in its hand, and I guess a finger had been on the trigger because the damn thing went off. A bullet went ricocheting around the room, sparking off bricks and causing the vamps to curse and the mage to shield, and me and Marlowe to just stay there staring at one another. Until it hit a guy who wasn't likely to complain about it, considering that he'd already been riddled by a dozen others. And for some reason, that broke the mood, whatever the hell it had been. After a moment, Marlowe offered me a hand up and asked if I was all right, which made me wonder if he was, because solicitous was not the word I'd use for the consul's chief spy. But he seemed a little thrown off kilter, and so was I, since I wasn't in the habit of Dorina just coming out like that. For centuries she hadn't been able to, being trapped behind the wall that Mircea had built to separate us. She emerged only when I was asleep or unconscious, or when my mental state was compromised due to rage, fear, or the adrenaline spike of battle. For a long time, I hadn't even realized that we were separate people, but had just thought of her as the Hyde to my Jekyll, the vampire alter ego who liked battle and mayhem and never missed a fight. But ever since the barrier fell, we'd been having a few moments, slowly getting to know each other. It was exciting after all these years to finally understand a little more about myself, but it was also disturbing and not remotely normal. Not that I'd ever known what normal was, but I definitely didn't anymore. So it was kind of a relief to look up from brushing myself off and find Marlowe on the other side of the room talking to his mage. All right then. Okay, back to work. 10 minutes later, I sat staring at the body I had just finished examining, which had the same puzzling omission as the last four. "Where are all the bullets?" I asked, but the corpse just stared mutely back. Of course that wasn't true of someone else.
"What bullets?" Marlowe demanded,
even though I'd mainly been talking to myself. I looked up. "That's what I mean. There aren't any."
"Of course there are."
He strode back over. I didn't say anything, just poked around some more in a hole on the guy's thigh. There was no exit wound, probably because the bullet had hit the femur and bounced off, burying itself in the meat behind his knee. Only it hadn't. The channel was there. I could follow the path the hot lead had torn easily enough with a finger, but there was no slug at the end of it. Just more meat. I sat back on my heels. Marlowe muttered something and squatted beside the corpse.
"You think you'd know better than this by now,"
he told me, searching around inside the vamp's hairy leg.
"We heal faster than you. Around sometimes gets lodged inside one of us because we heal over it before we can get out of a fight."
"I know that."
"Why do you think we keep bokors?"
he demanded, as if I hadn't spoken, and using the common term for the kind of necromancers who act as physicians for vamps.
"They have to call forth a captured bullet from the flesh, if it's buried too deep for us to expel on our..."
He trailed off, an annoyed and then puzzled expression chasing themselves across his face.
"Yeah, that one's buried deep,"
I agreed dryly, and started checking a couple more nearby bodies while Marlowe scowled at me.
"It's not in there," he said.
"I know it's not in there."
"Well, what did you do with it?"
I glanced up.
"I didn't do anything with it."
"Then what the hell happened to it?"
"How should I know?" I said, exasperated, because he was looking at me like I was a bullet thief.
"It's just gone, like the ones in those guys."
I gestured at the bodies I'd already checked, because they were also lacking slugs in their wounds, or anywhere else. Not to mention the brass casing said slugs had come in. With so many rounds fired in a contained space, I'd have expected spent brass to be littered all over the place, but there was none.
"Maybe they weren't shot after all, but killed by something else,"
Vamp Number One offered, peering over at us. He had plenty to peer with, being a pop-eyed, curly-haired blonde with love handles ruining the line of his nice blue suit. His companion, darker, sleeker, and without a hair out of place, winced slightly.
Marlowe rounded on him. "What do you smell?" he demanded.
Vamp Number One blinked at him.
"Smell?" "Yes, smell. Smell! You are a vampire, are you not?"
"Yes." The man sounded like he wasn't sure suddenly, with his master's dark gaze on him. His companion closed his eyes.
"Then what do you smell?"
The poor guy looked around as if searching for an answer that would get him out of this. He didn't find it.
"Mildew?"
"Gunpowder," the hound said, taking pity on his fellow vamp and cutting in before Marlowe could respond to that bit of idiocy.
"It's everywhere." "Along with 100 or so bullet holes,"
Marlowe added, still glaring at Vamp Number One.
"Holes, but no bullets," I added.
Because Marlowe was right, this place looked like the St. Valentine's Day Massacre despite the fact that we were in New York, not Chicago, and that it was a hot, sweaty September, not February, and about 100 years too late. But the number of scars on the old walls and floor looked like a couple Tommy guns had been at work, or an automatic weapon or three. Only somebody had then gone around afterward with half the neighborhood now awake and the cops on the way and picked up all the bullets? How was that even possible? Even out of the wounds?
"And something else I can't define."
That was the hound again, looking at the peppered wall beside him and frowning.
"If you don't have anything useful to add to the discussion, then at least... Wait, what?"
Marlowe broke off reprimanding Vamp One to do a double take on his hound.
"What do you mean, can't define? You're a hound."
It was a fair comment. Hounds weren't just vamps with great noses. They also had an encyclopedic knowledge of scents, a catalog in their heads of everyone they'd encountered in their often very prolonged lifetimes. As a result, They were better than a forensic department at telling you what had gone down in a room stretching back days or even weeks, along with identifying anyone who had been there if they'd ever so much as passed them in a hallway. They didn't just forget things. Of course, you can't forget what you've never encountered.
Something I've never smelled before,
the hound confirmed, quietly dignified, even when his master transferred the glare to him. Marlowe didn't say anything, because you can't reprimand a guy just for telling you what you don't want to hear. Or rather, you can, but Marlowe wasn't that kind of asshole. A lot of other kinds, but not that one.
Check them,
he snapped at his men, who started forward to obey. The mage cleared his throat.
If I may.
Marlowe glanced at him, then held up a hand to stop his men. The mage murmured something I couldn't hear and probably wouldn't have understood if I had. And the next thing I knew...
Son of a bitch!
Sorry. The man smirked at me while I wrestled with a gun in my boot, which wasn't in my boot any longer. It had suddenly decided to leap into the air and try to zoom off toward his uplifted hand. And then I had to duck as a dozen more, torn out of the hands of dead vamps, did likewise. They weren't the only ones. All around me, corpses were twitching, and in a few cases being dragged across the floor, smearing blood like paint behind them, because their guns were trapped in buckled holsters, I realized, still tucked under their arms or on their belts. One guy had a boot holster like mine, but something was preventing the gun from getting out, and he was wedged under a couple other corpses. But his leg wasn't, and it was shaking wildly in the air in the direction of the mage. Until the boot came off and went racing across the room straight at vamp number one. He'd been standing beside the mage, staring at the flying weapons being caught in the shield the man had erected in front of him, like a giant catcher's mitt, one that did not extend across his careless associate, who was kicked square between the pop eyes by the flying boot. The mage sighed. The other vamps were more coordinated, but they too were grabbing their holsters, which were being pulled outward from their bodies by their guns, or more likely, given what we were looking for, by the rounds in the guns. Guess I knew how all those bullets were retrieved, I thought, because they had been. Despite the mayhem, there were no slugs zinging around, testing the strength of the mage's shield. They weren't flying out of divots in the walls, giving off little puffs of ancient plaster. They weren't sliding around under dead skin, looking for an exit. They weren't doing anything because there weren't any there. But the mage didn't seem to realize this and just thought his spell wasn't strong enough. So he upped the power, judging by how the hair on my arms was suddenly standing on end and by how the old bricks had begun to move in the walls before bursting outward in a hail of shards, along with an ancient water pipe that slammed out at us and began drenching the scene.
Turn it off, Marlowe yelled. Turn it off!
I wasn't sure if he meant the water or the spell, but both were quickly dealt with. The mage dropped his arm, and the hound braved the flood to pinch off the ends of the pipe, cutting off the flow, leaving us standing around, dripping at each other.
I don't understand.
The mage looked genuinely confused, maybe because even after all that, his hand remained empty. I do, I said, and judging by Marlowe's steadily darkening expression, so did he. Somebody had developed bullets that could kill vamps and didn't want anybody to know about it, so they took them with them and left us a very big problem on our hands. 20 minutes later, Marlowe was propped in a corner with a blank look on his face, having a mental convo with somebody, probably his uber-creepy boss. The mage and the hound were going over the bodies I'd already checked out, like they were going to find something I'd missed, and the two guards were standing around being tits on a bull useless. Of course, I wasn't feeling much better. I sat back on my heels, wiping sweat off my face with an already drenched sleeve, because nobody had bothered to run air conditioning down here, and because I had just finished stripping the last body, whose clothes, like all the others, had yielded exactly squat. Well, almost. The The wallets, phones, and IDs of the corpses were missing, although plenty of expensive watches and assorted bling had been left behind. So not a robbery, then. Not that I'd really thought so. If you developed a new super weapon, a game changer that turned a regular gun into a vamp killer, you didn't need to lift a few wallets in order to eat. Of course, you also didn't need to spray said bullets around in what looked like a classic hit, or leave the corpses unburnt and littered everywhere, sans slugs but complete with the holes said slugs had caused, which would alert even the most bumbling authorities to what you had. And Marlowe wasn't bumbling. He hadn't noticed the bullets before I pointed them out because vamps didn't, as a rule. It would be like a human cop noticing a super soaker or a kid slingshot at a crime scene. It might get a line in his notes, in the interest of completeness, but it wouldn't be a priority. Nobody died from a super soaker. And the same was true for vamps and guns. Human weapons were barely an annoyance to a master like Marlowe, and even to baby vamps, they were more like rubber bullets or buckshot to a human. Irritating, but not lethal. At least, they weren't supposed to be. But Marlowe would have figured it out pretty soon, even without me. So why were these bodies here? Vamps burned like kerosene-soaked rags, so why not flick a bick and leave no evidence behind? It didn't make sense, and it was bothering me. Kind of like the clues that had been left behind, if you could call them that. The guys were all fashionistas, but not everyone had paid through the nose for it. Four, I thought, checking the latest bit of blood-soaked couture, hadn't bought their stuff on Savile Row or Rodeo Drive. No, they'd had it hand-fitted by master tailors in Hong Kong. The city wasn't printed on the labels, but I recognized some of the names, one in particular. Mircha's boys strive to keep up with their master's sartorial splendor, but don't always have the cash. So newbies are clued in by the older vamps to a cheaper and often better alternative. It's an open secret in the world of bespoke tailoring that the price of an airline ticket to Asia is more than made up for by the savings on even a few suits. And if you need a whole new wardrobe, well, then you head to Hong Kong's most famous fashion district. You head to Kowloon. But not to the shops with touts out front, ready to rip off the latest group of unsuspecting tourists, or to the new breed with flashy names and flashier prices, scarcely less than you'd pay anywhere. No, you go old school, down a tiny back alley lined with tinier shops, to a place where three or four master tailors labor under the watchful gaze of an eagle-eyed boss. You go to Wong's. I ran my fingers over the silky tag at the back of a very nice shirt. A few $100 in the U.S., or free in Hong Kong, if you ponied up for a $500 suit that fit like a glove, and wondered if it meant anything. Probably not, the way my night was going. I turned my attention to the body. This one was a Bruce Lee clone with, oddly enough, considering that he looked and dressed Chinese, what appeared to be a set of Yakuza tats down one side of his chest. The pattern was pretty enough, a bunch of intertwined koi, ironically supposed to symbolize good luck, although the six or so bullet holes peppering his skin kind of screwed up the design, especially the one that was moving. I blinked, and then moved closer for a better look. It was still hard to see because the koi were moving too. They swam in and out of a field of slowly drifting kelp, their bright orange skins contrasting nicely with the blue-gray water and teal-colored leaves. One of them flashed me a bright black eye, but didn't look too interested. Maybe because this type of magical tat drew its power from the wearer, charging up in down times to allow for an extra burst of strength or speed when needed. And this guy wasn't going to be powering anything ever again. But something in the design didn't need it. I leaned even closer, and the room abruptly went dark. It looked like somebody had pulled a shade that didn't exist because there were no windows down here. I was about to complain, vociferously, to my other half, because I couldn't do my job if I couldn't see. But then I did. A glister of gold spiraled up into the air in a delicate stream, like gilded pollen. It was so faint that I'd have never noticed it under the harsh lighting of the room, yet in the almost darkness it was brilliant. It cast tiny moving light shadows onto the vamp's naked chest, illuminating the skin around one of the wounds where it looked like something was... shit! I'd reached out a curious finger and drawn it back full of blood. My own. I was still staring at my mauled digit, which had four tiny but deep lines carved into it, when the perp made a break for it. Something shot out of the wound and into the shadows under the guy's bicep, moving like a bat out of hell. For a split second, I just stared, not sure what the heck I'd seen. Then I was flipping the vamp over and slamming my bloody hand down on the concrete and swiping and missing and... There was some kind of commotion by the door, but I barely noticed because I was on the chase, one that abruptly left the vamp's body behind and leapt to a nearby pile of his buddies, where something glinted and glimmered, taunted and tantalized, flashing in and out of a jumble of limbs and shadows. It sparkled in a fixed, staring eye for a second, then off the surface of a brightly shined shoe, before leaping to the ground and scurrying toward nothing, because I slammed a foot down on it. Just in time, I glanced up to see that the commotion in the doorway had become a full-on fight. A moment later, Marlowe's boys were thrown backwards by a much larger contingent of high-level vamps pushing down the stairs, with scowls on their faces and guns in their hands. Chapter 3. I froze, half bent over, while the crazed little thing I'd captured squirmed and thrashed like a miniature raptor, causing me to have to press down harder. That didn't seem to make it happy. It didn't make me happy either when what felt like a claw stabbed upwards through the thick sole of my boot and into the ball of my foot. But there was no time to do anything about it, since I'd just spotted a familiar face in the crowd of vamps pouring into the basement. The Honorable Zheng Zi was a huge, handsome Buddha type, if Buddha went on a diet and joined a serious gym. But the benevolent, often smiling face was the same, although it was paired with a weird sense of humor and almost as much love for mayhem as me. He gave me a nod, but didn't say anything, maybe because he wouldn't have been heard over the cursing anyway. And for once, it wasn't coming from Marlowe. Not that the chief spy didn't look apoplectic, but he was having trouble getting a word in. I pressed down harder on my captive, trying to trap it between my soul and the floor, while listening to a master class in Chinese invective. Or make that Cantonese invective, since the dressing down Marlowe was getting was in that language.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.